Major funding for this series is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by the financial support of viewers like you.
Corporate funding for the American Experience is provided by Aetna for more than 135 years, a part of the American Experience.
Hello, welcome to the American Experience. I'm David McCullough. In the background of our film tonight, you'll hear a famous song from the 1930s. Nearly everybody knew the words. Once in khaki suits, gee, we look swell, full of that Yankee doodle-dee-dum. Half a million boots went slogging through hell. I was the kid with the drum. Say, don't you remember? They called me Al. It was Al all the time. Say, don't you remember? I'm your pal. Brother, can you spare a dime? Brother, Can You Spare a Dime was written by Yip Harburg. It's about a World War I veteran who feels he's done plenty for his country, and now, down and out in the Depression, he's asking questions. And as Harburg explained, he's outraged, too. The Depression came in the wake of the stock market crash of 1929. In 3 years, more than 40 million people, fully a third of the country, were unemployed or members of a family in which the main breadwinner had no job. What had gone wrong? Where was all that promised prosperity? What could be done, and how soon? Because millions of people were going hungry. Should the government step in, or would old-fashioned American self-reliance see us through? These were profound questions. In the election year of 1932, the time of our story, thousands of veterans, like the one in the song, decided they'd had enough. They marched on Washington. It was a stark, ominous time. After the crash.
It's war, the greatest concentration of fighting troops in Washington since 1865. The 3rd Cavalry from Fort Myers and the 1st Light Tank Regiment, grim and relentless.
In 1932, two armies of Americans faced each other on the streets of the nation's capital. The U.S. Army and an army of World War I veterans whose belief in the American dream had been shattered. After 3 years of hard times, the country seemed to be coming apart. Hungry Americans were losing faith in government, and other Americans feared what hungry Americans might do. This is the story of how people began marching from farms and plantations, from the great industrial cities. Worst years of a time we now call the Great Depression.
All right, you're going to say newspaper angel. Hospital, come on. All right, hospital, you're going to be in
65. One of the first warnings of change in America was heard in the Cotton Belt, 1,000 miles from Washington, D.C. Here, poor tenant farmers and sharecroppers were not expected to go on the march. But they had been living through an agricultural depression for almost 10 years. And in the months after the stock market crash, their situation grew more desperate.
About the only industry we had, besides agriculture, were the processing plants, the compresses, cottonseed oil mills, the gins. And when agriculture got in trouble, all of these service industries were in trouble.
Then, in the summer of 1930, it stopped raining. Drought devastated half the states in the nation. Arkansas was the hardest hit.
It was so hot in July until that tender top of the corn, you know, where it's growing up, where the tulse will come out. Well, it would turn white.
Ground busted open and dried out, and the corn and the cotton and the garden stuff and everything just dried up, turned yellow and died.
If you imagine how a person can feel who sees that he's losing every damn thing he's got. All the money he's put into that crop, and you can just flat-footed sit there and see it going away, just blown away with the sun. You can imagine how he feels. He feels like hell.
I look back myself now and am surprised at how little awareness there seemed to be in Washington of what was going on around the country. Washington is the federal city. The federal government is the principal employer. There is not and never has been any large other source of employment than the federal government in Washington. The federal government doesn't go bankrupt.
Herbert Hoover had been president for a little more than a year. That summer, he asked Congress for farm loans and public works projects to help battle the Depression. But he opposed giving federal money directly to individuals. Hoover believed in private charity and self-help.
He felt that man's endeavors for himself were very important, that government should not be big brother. It was a concept that was quite prevalent at that time, up until suddenly everything was falling apart.
In Arkansas, Hoover asked the Red Cross to handle the relief effort.
Dear Red Cross, my children need books and clothes so they can go to school. If my mules don't die this winter, then I can get something for them to eat. I'm going to try to make a crop here next year. I don't want the Red Cross to give me nothing, but if you'll help me and give me time, I'll pay you for all that you do for me. Signed, A.C. Blount.
In some counties in Arkansas, planters discouraged outside aid, fearing sharecroppers would not work if provided with free food. In most counties, the Red Cross worked within the plantation system and relied on planters to determine who needed aid.
Your boss man, he would already go in front and he'd be told how many families he had on his place that needed aid. And so when you got out there, they would check each individual that was drawing for a household.
Sometimes we'd get flour, sometimes we'd get meal, you know, to help out. Otherwise, it's what we had to live on.
Starvation in my kitchen, rent signs on my door. Starvation in my kitchen, red signs on my door. And if my look don't change up, can't see her at my home no more.
By November, the local Red Cross was running out of funds. With winter approaching, livestock and people faced starvation.
To the Honorable Senator Joe T. Robinson. Dear Joe, many prominent citizens have urged me to write. The landlord's losses are so great that it is utterly impossible for them to put up a dollar for the maintenance and support of their tenants. And all of them are wondering how they'll be able to grow a crop during the year of 1931. Very truly yours, Thomas G. Trimble.
In a major challenge to Hoover's relief policy, U.S. senators proposed that the federal government lend money directly to people in need. The national debate about self-reliance and starvation was now on the floor of Congress.
My uncle, Senator Joseph T. Robinson, asked Congress for some help for the people in Arkansas. He didn't get it because the people in New York and Chicago and Boston and places like that said, if you help them, you've got to help us too. And of course, he couldn't do it. Of course, he couldn't help everybody. Didn't have the money.
In Washington, Hoover and Red Cross Chairman John Payne continued to insist that the Red Cross could handle the crisis.
An open letter to President Hoover. To say that people are not suffering of hunger and actually starving in Arkansas is a blind denial of plain facts. The Red Cross and the states that are stricken have not the resources to meet the situation. As an American citizen and as a soldier in the late World War, I am utterly disgusted to think it probable that my national government should shirk its inescapable duty in this time of peril. Respectfully, Oliver Moore.
By the end of the year, more than 150,000 Arkansas families were in desperate need.
Just come on us that we didn't have nothing to go on. Wintertime coming and didn't have anything from the summer.
Well, one of the worst moments that I can think of was just like December coming up, and you ain't got money to pay the Santa Claus. And that's tough, especially when it's, you know, young children.
You get hungry and you miss a payday, you get real antsy. Anybody does. And you get a feeling that world's gone to hell in a handbasket, and you can't position yourself in such a world.
On January 3rd, 1931, in the countryside around the town of England, Arkansas, hungry tenant farmers had no place to turn. The Red Cross had stopped distributing food. Families had not eaten for days. Reporter Lament Harris talked to Homer C. Coney, one of the farmers facing starvation.
We said, Mr. Coney, we know you went to town and led the farmers to get food. Tell us what happened. I'd be glad to. And he says, I was here, and I was in the same condition as about everybody else. And all of a sudden, a woman comes up, and she says, Coney, the kids ain't at for 3 days. What'll I do? And Coney said, something went right up in my head. And I says, you stay here. I'll get food for you. And we drove over to a neighbor's house where the Red Cross was supposed to operate, and there were people hanging around there waiting. And I got up in the truck and I said, listen to me. We shouldn't wait any longer. We're hungry. If you aren't yaller, come with me and we'll go to town and we'll get food.
500 farmers marched on the grocery store in England, Arkansas.
There's a pretty good man in town named Morris, Lawyer Morris. And he got out in front of Ben High's store, and he says, I know what you're here for, and give us a half hour, and there'll be no problem. And Coney said, I got right up on the truck. I wasn't going to hide or crawl under a car or anything. I let everybody see me. And I says, all right, we'll give you the half hour, but we got to have what we came for. And Lawyer Morris says he got on the telephone, and he called up Little Rock, Arkansas, the capital, Red Cross. And he says, look, the farmers are in town, hundreds of them. If you don't give us authorization, they're going to take the food. All right, we authorize. So they authorize $2.50 worth of food for everybody. We took it, and we went home.
This time, the farmers went home. But local officials predicted that the march in England, Arkansas, was merely the forerunner of similar trouble elsewhere. Though the confrontation had been peaceful, newspapers around the country called it a riot.
It was the kind of thing the newspapers couldn't ignore. And in the secret hearts of a lot of our leaders, community leaders, throughout the South, throughout the Midwest, was this feeling that we're on the edge of something, and we don't want to get it started here at home. That edge of something being a economic, social, and political revolution.
In the cities, the Depression pushed millions into poverty. They, too, were on the edge of something. By the beginning of 1931, one out of every six workers in the United States was unemployed. Thousands of families were being evicted. The homeless and hungry filled bread lines and moved into shanty towns they named Hoovervilles. Of all the big industrial centers, Detroit was the hardest hit.
Chrysler wasn't hired. General Motors wasn't hired. In fact, they began to lay off themselves. And as you got to remember, this was an auto industrial town. There was no other economy here. This whole town was built around automobiles.
With a quarter of a million Detroiters out of work, there was concern that protests here might lead to violence. The newly elected mayor, Frank Murphy, promised that no one would go hungry. But welfare payments were already draining the city treasury.
Murphy, to his credit, tried to keep the promise he had made and tried to give welfare to everybody that needed it, said he was going to. And, of course, the city didn't have that kind of money.
The city of Detroit was broke. Didn't have any money, just like any other city around, you know. And what little federal help was coming in was not enough to even make a dent for the unemployed people and the people who were living here in Detroit. You didn't have any federal programs like you have now. You did not have any Social Security. You didn't have any Medicare. You didn't have any social service agencies who's going to give you some help.
In Detroit, homeless people became a common sight. As the city ran out of money to subsidize rents for the unemployed, the number of evictions would rise to 150 families a day.
I was frightened by the evictions, and I think that my mother lived in fear that we would wind up on the streets. We'd come home from school, and there would be, on the walk home, dozens of people with their furniture out on the street, and they'd be sitting out there, and some of them would be weeping, the children would be crying, no place to go.
We were behind on our rent, 5 months behind at the time. And they had evicted a family and blocked it up where I lived. And so one of the guys said, well, let's send them back in. They wanted to beat the hell out of the process service at the time, but they said, look, I'm getting 75 cents to do this. That's what they were paying these guys, 75 cents to go out to evict you. And I don't give a damn what you do after I leave, but that's what we decided to do. After they would leave, we'd go put the people back in. And that began to spread, not only in our block, all over the east side.
Unemployed councils in the neighborhoods organized the movement against evictions. Many of the councils were led by members of the Communist Party. There were probably no more than 2,000 communists in the city, but they gained wide attention with their demands for housing, unemployment compensation, and labor's right to organize.
A time came when they called everybody a communist, including Frank Murphy, some people. But there was a hard rock group of card-carrying communists who unquestionably wanted to see a duplication in the United States and Detroit of the revolution in Russia, and going to rouse the masses.
The fact of the Depression gave a black eye to capitalism, of course, and made communism seem, it was unknown, nobody knew what communism really meant. But in those days, it was novel, it was different, it was something new, it was an alternative to what we had. And it had a great deal of appeal, yes, it was a serious thing.
Where was America going? The presidency, President of the United States, did not supply any of the answers. The papers were negative. They were scared stiff that the people would rebel or would look for answers elsewhere. The young people felt deserted, except the communists, the few radical agitators that came. And people were becoming impatient.
Hoover was feeling the pressure. In his efforts to battle the Depression, he had spent more money than any peacetime president in American history. But the money had gone to business and to state government in the belief that stimulating the economy at the top would create jobs for those at the bottom.
The president didn't panic. He had confidence in himself, and he knew where he was going and what he wanted to do. And he just did it the best he could.
Hoover still hoped that charity and local government would deal with problems of hunger and housing. But in Detroit, local government was being overwhelmed. By the summer of 1931, the city's funds were almost exhausted. Detroit dropped thousands of families from welfare. A Detroit physician told the press he now estimated one death from starvation every 7 hours.
It was the not knowing where our next meal was coming from. And our mother was so anxious, and the anxiety was contagious. What bothered me more than anything was the arguments that my mother and father had at night. Arguments because there was no food, and arguments about sex because my mother was afraid there'd be another child. And I used to lie there and put the pillow over my head and just really quiver inside. And I felt terrible about my mother, just terrible, and there wasn't anything we could do. And we could try not to complain, but when you're hungry and when you're cold and you're small, that's very difficult.
Automobile manufacturer Henry Ford offered to help with the welfare crisis.
I know that he loaned his employees that were not working money. He loaned them the money. Henry Ford wasn't really the kind of give money. He didn't believe in it, but he loaned them the money. I know that at that time he loaned the city of Detroit $5 million. But Mr. Ford also had his own problems. He had bills to pay himself.
In August, the Ford Motor Company, the Detroit area's largest employer, began to shut down its production lines to retool for the new Ford V8. In the 4 months leading to the shutdown, more than 40,000 workers lost their jobs.
Henry Ford was just another person. I don't think he missed a meal, I'm sure of that. But he was up against the wall, too. In 1931, he had to come out with a product because his car had had it. The Model A didn't last as long as his famous Model T.
And when he closed the plant, naturally that had an economic effect on not only the people who had been laid off, but on the city as a whole. You could see the effect of what Ford did. What you had was an area of starvation. What you had was an area in a time of deprivation. What you had was an area of time of non-care on the part of the federal government. In fact, it boiled down Just a few had every damn thing, and the many didn't have anything.
Now, Hoover was losing support, even from longtime allies in the American Legion. In September, the Legion met in National Convention in Detroit. Members debated federal aid for veterans in the form of an immediate cash bonus. The president made an emergency trip to Detroit to stop the bonus movement.
But there is today even a greater service to our country. And that is the determined opposition by you, as a great body of influential men, to any additional demands upon the nation until we have won this war against a world depression.
After the speech, police rushed the president out of downtown Detroit. With large numbers of unemployed in the city, Hoover's staff was concerned for his safety.
We were frightened. We were really frightened. And I think probably the Secret Service, I know the Secret Service men were frightened too for the president. It was a very anxious time.
If you would walk down the streets in Detroit, you would hear people saying the leadership in Washington wasn't worth a damn. You would hear people say, where in the hell is the chicken in every pot and the two cars in every garage? And you would hear them discussing, let's form our own party or let's march on Washington. The Republicans or Democrats aren't worth a damn. You saw veterans who'd been in World War I going to the veteran post, the American Legion post, and saying that they had been betrayed.
Across the country, more than 800 banks failed in September and October 1931. On Thanksgiving, the president urged Americans to help each other. Again, he refused to provide direct federal relief.
The measure of passing adversity which has come upon us should deepen the spiritual life of the people, quicken their sympathy and spirit of self-sacrifice for others, and strengthen their courage.
That winter in Detroit, the city fed 30,000 people a day at public food kitchens and neighborhood fire stations. With hunger stalking the streets, Detroit's unemployed councils called for more protest marches.
People were prepared to, not only here in Detroit, to do something real drastic, because they could not continue to live under the conditions that the federal government and the corporations had imposed on them.
Somebody brought the question of so many of the people who were out of work being Ford workers. And since the Ford Motor Company was down on this retooling situation, they felt that Ford had a responsibility for these people.
And when you take a group of people, I don't give a damn who they are, who've been subjected to unemployment, no income, and seeing their families suffer over a period of time, the string is going to snap somewhere.
3,000 jobless Detroiters demanded that Ford provide relief for laid-off employees. On March 7, 1932, led by communist organizers, they marched in sub-freezing weather to Ford's River Rouge plant in the city of Dearborn.
There were individuals in that march who were preachers. There were church people in that march. There were workers in that march.
There weren't a lot of women, but there were some. And there weren't a lot of children, but there were some.
Waiting for the marchers on Miller Road were Dearborn police and armed Ford security guards.
And when we got to Miller Road and Dix, that's when we were challenged by the service department in the city of Dearborn Police Department. They told us we couldn't go any further. A quick meeting was held. And it was decided that we would march on.
When the marchers left the Detroit city limits, they entered Ford territory. Police in Dearborn met them with tear gas and near-freezing water from high-pressure fire hoses. Marchers answered with bricks and stones, injuring several policemen. The police and Ford security guards then opened fire on the crowd. A marcher filmed the confrontation while running from the gunfire.
And I dashed over. I just saw the smoke. Bella Road was covered with smoke from shooting and from tear gas.
I saw people who were bleeding, and then I learned from a couple of fellows that some people had been shot, and he said he thought one had been killed.
Four marchers were killed that day on Miller Road. More than 20 wounded. Many Detroiters called it the massacre at River Rouge.
I mean, the fact that we were hungry and we were cold was one thing, but that people were being killed because of it just made the situation that much worse.
You lived with fear. You were learning very fast that in many, many ways, this was far from being the free country that you had heard about, that you hoped it would be.
Detroit communists organized the funeral. As the caskets were carried to the street, a band struck up the Internationale, the communist anthem. But it became clear that the deaths angered more than the communists. 25,000 Detroiters gathered along the line of march to Woodmere Cemetery. They buried the men within sight of the smokestacks of River Rouge. In the spring of 1932, an army of the unemployed rolled across the United States toward Washington, D.C. Within months, they would threaten Herbert Hoover's political future and would shake the faith of many Americans in their government. It all began when ex-Army Sergeant Walter W. Waters led 300 veterans out of Portland, Oregon. Their goal? To claim a bonus for service in World War I. Congress had promised to pay the bonus in 1945, but the veterans wanted their money now. With increasing numbers of veterans hopping freight trains to Washington, confrontations along the way began to make national news. Other veterans, hearing of the bonus army, also began moving toward the Capitol.
Father came home one day and said to my mother, pack up the kids. We're going to Washington, D.C. for the bonus army.
One nation! With liberty.
And justice for all.
My uncle, Sam, was the first in our family to ever go east to the nation's capital because he felt compelled to see that the bonus was paid off.
If there was a bonus army going to Washington, D.C., my dad wouldn't miss it for the world. He was very anti the Hoover administration and the trickle-down economy of that particular era. It was an adventure. We all got in the trucks, and we would drive to the outskirts of town. We'd get out of the trucks, and then we would march through the town with our signs and so forth. And my brother and I and several other children, we held a large American flag in our hands, open, spread out like a spread. And as we marched through the town, the townspeople threw nickels and dimes into the flag. And that was the funding for food and gasoline.
Once I built a tower, now it's gone. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once in khaki suits, see, we look swell. Full of that Yankee doodle dum. Half a million boots went slogging through hell, and I was a kid with a drum.
The president and many in Congress attempted to discourage the bonus movement. But the veterans kept coming.
Say, don't you remember?
By the time they arrived in Washington, the entire nation knew about the bonus army.
We went down there with carloads of trucks, some guys in cars, come from all over the country. We all were grouped up and we marched in. Had our leader, I think we had a band there too, going in, marching like a real parade, you know what I mean?
Unlike other protesters who marched on Washington and then went home, the veterans promised to camp out in the city until a new bonus bill was signed into law. Washington's police chief, Pelham Glassford, housed the first arrivals in abandoned buildings along Pennsylvania Avenue, just a few blocks from Capitol Hill. But as homeless men and their families continued to pour in, the police chief sent them outside the city to the mud flats along the Anacostia River. In case of riot, Glassford knew he could close the bridge to Anacostia Flats and keep the veterans out of downtown Washington. Glassford and many on the Washington police force were sympathetic to the veterans.
He said, look, you're going to be here for a while. Don't do nothing wrong. I'm going to give you all you want, and nobody's going to hurt you. And I'm going to help you guys, because he was in the service, too.
I went on the police department at a salary of $1,900 a year. And in 2 months after on the police department, they cut us 10%. But I was drawing a check every 2 weeks, and there was millions of people in the United States that was not drawing that. I was happy. I was ecstatic. I could pay for my clothes. I could buy my motorcycle shoes that I had to buy. Other people couldn't do this. But these people that made these marches, it was terrific.
At the end of May, Walter Waters assumed command of the entire bonus army in Washington. With more veterans arriving every day, the U.S. military under Secretary of War Patrick J. Hurley and General Douglas MacArthur ordered tanks to move closer to the city. At the White House, the Secret Service requested that troops be prepared to defend the president at a moment's notice. Communist organizers around the country announced that the bonus army had been their idea. Although never numbering more than 200, their presence in Washington worried the U.S. military and many in Congress.
I didn't like the idea of getting many ultra-radicals, some communists mixed with them, and others left, extreme leftists mixed all together, making a big turmoil about it. I thought that was the wrong way to get any bonus. Although in my heart I believed it, I didn't believe in this way of doing it. And I think I said so at the time.
The veterans are badly advised and badly led in marching upon Washington to collect a debt which is not due at this time and which the Congress does not propose to be coerced by any groups, veteran or any other, into voting a bonus bill in the present session of Congress.
The bonus would cost more than the government would take in that year. Committed to a balanced budget, Hoover asked the Senate to save the country from what he called the road to ruin.
In your hands at this moment is the answer to the question whether democracy has the capacity to act speedily enough to save itself in emergency.
Within weeks, the veterans had grown to an army of 20,000 and had lobbied hard to overcome opposition in both houses of Congress. On June 15th, they moved one step forward when the House of Representatives passed the bonus bill. The veterans began to believe they could win.
I don't think Washington really understood what had happened in the country and began to realize that something had to be done about it. until you got the bonus marches coming there and descending on Washington and lobbying the Congress every day and settling into makeshift dwellings all around the Capitol. That was what brought the Depression home to government.
Now, the veterans turned out to push the bonus through the Senate. But just 2 days after the victory in the House, the Senate voted to kill the bill. The news stunned the crowd.
I remember walking down that long flight of steps from the Senate building and seeing thousands of people milling about, crowds on the steps, on the grass, in front of the building. I think there was probably a sense of great confusion. What in the world do I do now? I've come all the way from California or Arkansas to try to get the bonus awarded so I can feed my kids. And Senate hasn't done anything about it. What do we do now?
The veterans refused to accept defeat and hoped to force Congress to reconsider the bill. In the next few weeks, veterans continued to arrive in Washington. The numbers in the camps started to increase. As the government watched with concern, the men began to turn their temporary camps into permanent homes.
I'm just a poor ex-soldier that's broken down and blue. I fought out in a great world war for the old red, white, and blue. I left my parents and the girl I loved to.
There were a lot of what I would call middle-class people. There was a sort of a leveling process as these people got together, and there was a sense of solidarity and a sense of responsibility to give a good account of themselves. There were some professional people. There were a good many women and a good many children. They tried to give little homey touches to the hovels they lived in. Some of them were built of cardboard, some of tin sheeting, some of wood. A number of them had planted little gardens.
The police department would try to get food from grocery stores that was going to be thrown away, or any food left over at the restaurants. They would call the police department and they would send a paddy wagon around and collect the food and distribute it among the veterans. And a lot of people from the country did the same thing.
But I remember moving into the tent city, and then we had a large tent that was ours, and we had army cots in the tent to sleep on, and we had army blankets.
From the earliest days of the encampments, President Hoover had secretly authorized the delivery of government supplies and medical care to the veterans. With the bonus bill defeated, Hoover wanted the veterans out of Washington. He obtained $100,000 from Congress to buy them train tickets home.
Tomorrow!
The veterans considered Police Chief Glassford their ally. But now Glassford also encouraged them to leave before the offer of transportation expired.
Better go while you can.
Why was it that you came to Washington?
Why, to beat the Undertaker, spend the money before the Undertaker gets it. I came to Washington to get my bonus, and I'm going to wait for till I get it if I have to wait till 1945.
With Congress scheduled to adjourn, the veterans mounted a final protest. For more than 3 days, they marched in front of the Capitol in slow, shuffling relays of tired men. The Washington press called it a death march.
The atmosphere around the Capitol building was very strange during the death march. There was a sense of sadness, of desperation, which I can't forget. The bonus marchers themselves didn't make much noise, and maybe they didn't have enough energy. And there were families sitting around near where the marchers marched. And the families looked grim. It was just somber. And it was very unnatural. Human beings just don't behave this way in normal circumstances.
All in favor, say aye.
A few minutes before midnight on the last night of the death march, Congress adjourned without passing the bonus bill. Members of both houses left through underground tunnels to avoid the veterans waiting outside.
I think the feeling began to change after Congress adjourned and the veterans stayed on, because there was no reason for them, as far as we could figure, no reason for them to stay there. They would gain nothing with the Congress out of town.
Take it from me, this is the greatest demonstration of Americanism we've ever had. Pure Americanism. Willing to take this beating as you've taken it. Stand right steady. You keep every law. And why in the hell shouldn't you? Who in the hell has done all the bleeding for this country and for this law and this Constitution anyhow but you fellas? But don't take a step back. Remember, as soon as you haul down your camp flag here and clear out this thing, every one of you clears out, this evaporates in thin air. And all this struggle will have been no good.
We drove through Washington as fast as we could. We didn't feel comfortable stopping at a stop sign, especially along Pennsylvania Avenue. And I had to cross Pennsylvania Avenue to get into the White House. And we rolled up our windows and locked our doors. And, well, it was a ragtag bunch of people. It was a mess there in Washington. And we weren't happy about it one bit.
Washington authorities wanted their city back. 12 days after Congress adjourned, the district commissioners ordered police to evict the veterans from the buildings on Pennsylvania Avenue.
We had no special training to handle riots. I don't think anybody on the police department had any idea that we'd be, including especially the officials, that we would be faced with anything when it finally came up.
Hundreds of angry veterans poured across the bridge from the main camp at Anacostia into downtown. President Hoover called for federal troops, but he kept the Washington police in charge and ordered General MacArthur to limit military action to the area of disturbance on Pennsylvania Avenue. Before the troops arrived, police and veterans clashed again. This time, the police opened fire. One veteran was killed. Another lay dying. By 4 o'clock that afternoon, Army troops were in position behind the White House. Within the hour, two rival armies of Americans would collide on the streets of Washington.
We heard this noise coming up Pennsylvania Avenue and looked down, and here was the troops coming from Fort Myer. In front was the cavalry, followed by the little Whippet tanks from World War I, and then back of them came the troop with General MacArthur and Major Eisenhower leading the way. The cavalry men pulled their sabers out of their scabbards. The troops fixed bayonets.
I was behind a line of cavalry, mounted men on horseback, and I heard a bugle sound, and they all drew their sabers, and then another bugle sound, and they started, the whole line started forward at a walk, and most of the bonus marchers went away in front of the horses. But one man held his ground, and I saw that saber swing down and hit the man's on the side of the head, and I saw blood on the ear. Whether he sliced the ear off, I'm not sure.
MacArthur's orders from the president were to surround the veterans in the abandoned buildings on Pennsylvania Avenue. In direct violation of those orders, he began to clear the entire city of the bonus army.
The army had the tear gas confused the veterans. It was a feeling of frustration. You know you couldn't do anything it was something that I'll never forget.
I happened to be near General MacArthur, and I saw him speak to a sergeant, and then I saw the sergeant collect a squad and then go down the row of ramshackle huts, and they'd throw a wad of newspaper into a corner of a hut and set that alight, and they went right down the whole row that way, and pretty soon the whole row was burning.
While MacArthur's troops mopped up downtown, three of his tanks held the bridge leading to Anacostia. Trapped inside the camp with the veterans were 600 of their wives and children.
My father was away from the tent, came back and told my mother that they were going to march on the Capitol. He was going to march in force. And, of course, my mother was a little upset about it. Started to go across the bridge, and when we got almost to the other side, there was the army with their horses and their soldiers with their bayonets and the tanks. It was a frightening experience. It really scared the hell out of me.
Twice that night, the president ordered MacArthur not to cross into Anacostia. But the general chose to ignore civilian authority. A few minutes after 11 p.m., he sent his troops across the bridge. By midnight, all of Washington could see Anacostia burning.
What had gone on reinforced my feeling that it was too bad that the richest country in the world couldn't do a better job of caring for its own people. I just thought America didn't give a very good account of itself that night.
While the ruins of Anacostia smoldered, General MacArthur reported that the veterans had intended to take over the government. Although MacArthur had violated direct orders, President Hoover took full responsibility for the eviction of the Bonus Army. In Albany, New York, Franklin Roosevelt, the Democratic candidate for president, listened to radio reports of the rout and concluded that Hoover had already lost the election. The veterans filled the roads leading out of Washington. Now refugees from their own government, they disappeared back into the America from which they had come. But the nation had changed. And many now question some of its most fundamental assumptions about what kind of loyalty the people owed the government and about what the government owed the people in the hardest of hard times.
Join us next Monday for the episode Roots of Resistance, a story of the Underground Railroad. That's 1 week from tonight. Right now, stay tuned as KTEH's Monday Public Affairs Night continues with Malone and a discussion of the growing problem of computer security. That's next on member-supported KTEH.
Major funding for this series is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by the financial support of viewers like you.
Corporate funding for the American Experience is provided by Aetna for more than 135 years, a part of the American Experience.
For video cassette information about this program, please write PBS Video, 1320 Braddock Place, Alexandria, Virginia, 22314. This is PBS. For a printed transcript of any American Experience program, send $5 to the American Experience Transcripts, Journal Graphics, 267 Broadway, New York, New York, 10007. To order by credit card, call 212-227-READ. Please specify program subject and date.
A look back at a dark time in our nation's history after the crash on the American Experience. Good evening. My name is Gary Martinez, and I'm the new host for Public Affairs Night. Coming up in just a moment, Michael Malone will be discussing computer security with two leading experts. But first, here's a reminder that this Wednesday we begin something new here at KTEH. In fact, it's new to the Bay Area. We'll be presenting an entire night of how-to shows, telling everything from how to take care of your pets to how to do major remodeling on your home. This is a night of programs that could save you money. Here's a preview.
Wednesday How-To Night kicks off with our own live call-in pet show, Pet Puri. Then discover our rich natural heritage on Wild America. Next, the Frugal Gourmet cooks up delicious and economical menus. Then see the latest home renovation techniques on This Old House. Next, learn how to build furniture on the new Yankee Workshop. And for remodeling and landscaping techniques, turn to home time. It all starts Wednesdays at 8 o'clock on How To Night.
The programs you enjoy on KTEH are made possible in part by the financial support of Communicart, Center for Graphic Design, Typesetting, and Printing, now with two locations in Santa Clara. By Syntex, developing innovative medicines and diagnostic systems to enhance the quality of life. And by Navlay's Fine Flowers, providing floral service to the Santa Clara Valley since 1885.
If you want to know what's going on in the fast-paced world of technology, and you want to see where it's taking you, join me, John Crump, for the Silicon Valley Report. We'll not only keep you up to date, but we'll also give you perspective on technology's promises and realities. The Silicon Valley Report, Thursday nights at 9 o'clock.
And we'd like to point out that the Silicon Valley Report is being produced right here at KTEH. Right now, it's time for another program that we produce, Malone. Tonight's show ties in quite nicely with the upcoming Silicon Valley Report. The subject, computers at risk. Just how vulnerable are our nation's computers to sabotage? Here's Malone on KTEH's Public Affairs Night.
Major funding for Malone has been provided by Applied Materials, producing wafer fabrication systems for the global semiconductor industry.
Hi, I'm Mike Malone. Is government oversight of the nation's computer systems necessary to stop high-tech terrorism? Or would such intervention cause more problems than it solves? Tonight, preventing computer crime with our guests. Don Parker, computer crime expert at SRI. Dorothy Denning, computer security specialist with Digital Equipment Corporation. And Glenn Tenney, organizer of the annual Hackers Conference.